There may be snow on the ground around North America, but it's starting to thaw, and here's how we know why. There is baseball being played safely on diamonds all around the United States. Hi there, folks. My name is Darren Sutton. This is Perfect Game Weekly, the only show devoted to amateur baseball on Perfect Game TV. This week, we shine a light on college baseball because it's underway. Look, specifically, junior college baseball's Brian Sakowski will join us and talk about the very best in the junior college ranks, teams and players. Excited to do that, certainly. We're going to find out how a young man finds his way to college as a 2024 in the middle of a COVID season. A very gifted switch hitter. How did the Sharp family find Michigan? We're going to talk with the legendary head coach, going back to the junior college thoughts of Chipola, with Jeff Johnson. Jeff Johnson, who's chasing 1,000 wins, will tell us how he has evolved, how he's underway. He's 6-1 in January, off to an incredible start. And then a young man who wasn't a top PG guy coming out of high school, who turned himself into a major leaguer with the Minnesota Twins, using the springboard of college baseball. Excited about this show. And we kind of turn the wheel toward junior college once again and talk about the elite baseball players that you know, Hall of Fame type players that started at the junior college ranks. I think this is a great way to remind all of you that are watching about the junior college impact of like an Albert Pujols, of a Kirby Puckett, of a Roger Clemens at San Jack. Of course, that 50 plus round pick of Mike Piazza out of junior college in Florida, Jorge Posada, like Pujols, came to the States, needed a place to play, played at Calhoun. But let's get started with junior college baseball. And we love talking with Brian Sakowski. Brian, junior college baseball changed dramatically because of COVID last year. As we look at it this year, they're already playing, and as I was saying a moment ago, but as we look at it, how dramatically did COVID change the face of junior college baseball as it pertains to prospects and depth of teams?
Yeah, it's a different year, obviously, as a result of that. There's a ton of players at junior college level right now who were there last year, who normally would have gotten drafted in a 40-round draft or even a 20-round draft, or if they hadn't, they'd have moved on to their four-year school of choice. Some of those guys are now back. But yeah, it's a very deep quality level right now, as it always is. But there's a lot of players who probably shouldn't be there in 2021 who are, and that's as a result of the pandemic.
All right, let's roll and talk about some of those programs. And College of Southern Nevada is at the very top of that list. It's interesting. You go Nevada, Illinois, Arizona, Texas, Missouri, with schools from those states. I love, first of all, that fact that it's so spread around the country. But kind of dive in and go where you'd like to go with the teams in the top five.
It was really CSN and Wabash, our number one and two, when I was really thinking about the preseason number one. Those were kind of the two. Looking back on it, I wish I maybe would have considered Grayson in Texas also, but that's with the benefit of hindsight. But yeah, CSN's just loaded. They're loaded with prospects. They're loaded with guys who are going to be good college players who maybe aren't draft types yet. They're deep in terms of the veterans they brought back. One of the aces on the mound, Johnny Cuevas, is a third-year guy. He wouldn't be back. Like, that's a guy who we had in the top 10 rounds of the draft board a year ago. Another guy is Dax Fellows, the shortstop. He's committed to Oregon. Another guy who I think in a regular draft would have gone. And on the other side of that, they have a freshman named Josh Swales there, who in a normal year would have been taken out of high school probably in the top 10 rounds, or like an overpay guy in the 11th round. He's at CSN throwing 94, 97 mile an hour bowling balls, and he's like the number four ranked prospect on our preseason JUCO board. Those are all guys that shouldn't be there but are. So just that little bit of kind of ace quality is what pushed CSN to the top for me. But Wabash is right there with them, man. Those two schools, I'd expect them, you know, if you were making me pick, I think that final game in Grand Junction, if those two are up going against each other, could be really fun.
So hard to win that. Even if you're talented, you have to win so many places. You have to win so... You had me at bowling balls, by the way, throwing a bowling ball from the mound. For you casual baseball fans, that means, like, think Brandon Webb sinker. That's what it means, but it's harder, right? I mean, that's not 80. A bowling ball is like 94 with sink, correct?
Mm-hmm.
I love scout terms. I love when you come on with scout terms. Hey, 6-10. Again, Texas, Louisiana, Florida, Tennessee. And we'll talk to Jeff Johnson, the head coach at Chipola, but Chipola's in your 10 spot. You know, go where you'd like to go, 6-10. Just kind of hit some high points for those teams.
Yeah, I mentioned Grayson a little bit already as far as a team that maybe I should have given a little bit more credit to. And I ranked them sixth. You know, I thought they were going to be really good, but they're just like beating people. And it's not they're winning, they're beating people. And it's a really, really good offense top to bottom. I'm still waiting to kind of see the depth of the pitching, but their ace is as good as anybody in the country. And Shea Hardis, he can beat anybody. He's going to go to Texas Tech next year if he's not drafted. And number seven is LSU Eunice, which is a little unique in that they are the first NJCAA Division II school we have. Eunice is our number one D2 school, and like it wouldn't surprise me even one little bit if they're number one at the end of the year. They were 21-0 last year before COVID and brought back the whole team with the exception of one or two guys. Historically great program there. And then, of course, we got to touch on Chipola if Coach Johnson is coming on the show.
He's a big fan of yours, by the way. He's a huge fan of yours. I just thought I'd share he's a big fan. Even yeah, I think he was disappointed that I'm doing the interview, so I have to apologize to him. He loves you. Everyone loves you in the JUCO world. Continue.
I took way too much of his time already getting him to break down his team for me. So, yeah. But they're really strong, as they always are. The pitching looks really good. There's probably four or five guys who can run into the mid-90s for them. Some guys who have had some success with the bat. They got a couple really good transfers at the break, including former PG All-American Miles Austin, who's already off to a really good start for them. Just, you know, a really good team who is expected to be really good every single year. And it's almost a disappointment at that point if they don't make it to Grand Junction.
Let's talk top dudes, you know, your list of guys that, you know, let's say in your top 10 to 15. I noticed when I looked at that list, a lot of pitchers.
Yeah, there was anywhere from like 5 to 7 guys that I'd really considered for number one. We went with Ricky Tiedemann, who was a freshman just last year, whose senior year was cut short by COVID, and he was committed to San Diego State, but opted to go JUCO. He's at Long Beach, and now Long Beach, I don't know if California JUCO is even going to play. So he's our number one, skinny lefty, lanky projection, you know, really good changeup up to 94. Really like the upside there long term. And then after him, it's flamethrowers, really. It's Christian McGowan at Eastern Oklahoma. He's a big righty who's up to 97, 98 with a breaking ball, Texas Tech commit. Hunter Parks at Florence Darlington is a guy that I really like personally. I think that we are at Perfect Game. Just really buy into the arm speed there. I think he's going to throw extremely hard, and he already does. Just, it's arms, man. The top bat we have is Dayton Dooney, who is kind of a second baseman, third baseman at Central Arizona. He was a freshman All-American at U of A a couple springs ago. Universally acclaimed as maybe the best bat in JUCO. Think that's going to be a really good player. He is a really good player. Has a chance to be a draft type this spring. Just a really, really strong class, man. Really strong class.
Last year, that 5-round draft, Brian, what was it? Was it 3 JUCO guys that got drafted? I know a lot of JUCO guys should have gotten drafted. I remember Luke Little, certainly, but it was just a small amount of junior college guys because it was only 5 rounds, right?
Right. I think there were 4. Little and Mitchell Parker from San Jack, Beck Way from Northwest Florida, and Connor Phillips from McLennan. Those were 4 for sure. I may be missing one.
I love Beck Way. I love Beck Way, by the way.
Great.
Yeah.
D2 guy who was loud on the Cape and then went to JUCO and 4th rounder, done. There's usually 100, 105 JUCO players taken on average. And even if you were to have cut the draft to 20 rounds, I still think there were probably 15 to 20 JUCO guys who didn't get drafted who would have.
It's crazy. I'm gonna use your Michigan expertise before we let you go and ask you about a 24 by the name of Reggie Sharp from the Grosse Pointe area. He went to a bunch of PG showcases last year. As a matter of fact, I saw you guys kind of take him from a couple years ago, a 7 to a 9 at that main event. Tell me from your perspective who Reggie Sharp is as an athlete.
He's a really good kind of advanced bat to ball guy. And you don't see that a ton in kids that young yet. You see the bat speed, you see, you know, the projection on the body, and you see kind of the ability to adjust the barrel. But Sharp just hits from both sides. There's a lot to like about the swing from both sides. There's impact. He sprays the field. He's small now, but he's also 15. So, like, who cares? We'll see how the muscle packs on. And he's got a lean frame with some wiry strength already. And I think there'll be some power there. And a really good athlete who covers a lot of ground. And we've liked watching the progression. And that's what scouts want. We want to see you get better every time we see you. That's kind of the ideal thing. And for him, it's been like that. It's been from when we first saw him at 13 or 14 to progressively honing his game and getting more physical and impacting the baseball more and running better, all of those things combined. And he's on the upswing and will continue to be.
Well, good stuff. We wanted to use your Michigan expertise, and thank you for the depth of knowledge that you provide for us on the JUCO side, my friend. Thank you, Brian.
Thanks, Seth. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, it's an interesting thing when you think about COVID and you dream of playing for your home state school. And for Reggie Sharp, he was able to pull it all together. He did the work as an athlete. There's no doubt. There's no denying who he is. But then how did the University of Michigan and the Sharp family come together? We recently found out.
The virtual tour of Michigan, I FaceTimed Bakich, and the first thing that he did was he showed me around the meeting area and everything where they do their team meetings and the offices and everything like that. And he walked me onto the field and he went straight to shortstop and he's like, "This is where you'll be playing," or like, "Doesn't this view look great," or something. And then he took me inside to his office first, and that is where I talked to Bakich, and he ended up offering me there on the spot, and I said yes. It's the best feeling of my life. That was the best time of my life, and it was the day before my birthday, so it was a great birthday present. Turning 15, to be committed, have a huge weight off my shoulders, because everything before that was kind of like, what am I going to do to get committed? What am I going to do to maximize like my potential and all that? It's still maximizing my potential, but now I can really focus on being smoother and maximizing everything without having to worry about where I'm going to school. I already know where I'm going to school, and I can focus on different things now. So 2021, with the coronavirus, I hope that it'll go away as much as it can, and we can get back on the field and play as much as we can. And I just wanna play as much as I can, honestly, because this past year I have not been able to play, and it's been very disappointing, and it's been sad to see a lot of older kids' chances be messed up. So I can't wait till 2021. I'll be able to play. And just get better. I just want to get better.
And I think Brian Sakowski said it best early. This is a diminutive guy who won't be for much longer. Look at the impact and consider this is a 14. This is a guy who's a 14U athlete, just turned 15. And you can see where he ranks in his class. Incredible stuff. Excited. I mean, really excited about the future of Reggie Sharp using technology to be recruited. And when we come back, a conversation with the dean and legend of junior college coaches, a man who has won 3 national championships. We'll go to Florida. We'll go to Jeff Johnson. It's Chipola. What a great program that is. Thanks for hanging out with us. This is Perfect Game Weekly. To Perfect Game Weekly. G-Form presents Guess the Alumni. Now, this is a fun one because this was a PG All-American. It's a guy you've certainly heard of now. He did amazing things at Southern Nevada, which, by the way, is a junior college, and he was much younger than he should have been. He was so young, and yet he put up those ridiculous numbers. I think you know who it is, but can you guess who it is right now? JUCO star he was. Jeff Johnson is a star as a head coach, and he's had many stars come through campus in Florida at Chipola Junior College, and he joins us now. Jeff, thanks for spending time with us. We really appreciate it. We're enjoying dedicating this show, at least a large portion of it, to the junior college baseball program. for you guys, help us understand what COVID did to junior college baseball with all the extra years that four-year guys got, with the flush of players coming to your level. Explain how COVID, probably in a positive way, I hope, affected junior college baseball, Jeff.
Well, you know what's happened to us, Darren, is, you know, we've got a lot of older kids in the junior college level now, which is happening at Division I too, but it's put an influx of players into college baseball. You know, I think that, along with the draft last year being five rounds and having the COVID freshmen, the COVID sophomores, what we call them now, it added a lot more talent into college baseball, especially junior college baseball. I was talking with a scout buddy of mine yesterday, and he was telling me he thought the state of Florida was probably the deepest it's ever been in his scouting days with players this year.
Mariana, Florida, up north, and heading right towards that panhandle. That's where Chipola is. Jeff Johnson is their head coach. You talk about scouts. Your role as a junior college coach, especially with a two-year program, how often do you communicate with scouts, with four-year schools, on behalf of your athletes? It seems like that's one of the reasons Chipola is so successful.
Well, you've got to develop your players. You got to promote your players. And you know, once your players are moving on to the next level, whether that be a four-year university or professional baseball, it says you've done a good job with your development. But it's what the kids want to see, too. You know, it's what the players want to see. You know, all of them got dreams and aspirations of playing professionally. There's a small percentage of those that are going to be able to do that. But the other guys have gotten to understand, you know, whether that be a NAIA Division II, a low, mid, or high major Division I, they want to take those steps and be able to play as long as they can play, you know, the game of baseball.
Baseball Reference has unofficially 155 players drafted out of your program, which is a crazy number. And for the casual fan, slugger Jose Bautista, legend catcher Russell Martin, guy like Pat Corbin, talented left-handed pitcher. How often do these junior college players at one time keep in touch with where they came from? How much do you hear from those guys?
You know, we hear from them a good bit. You know, I stay in touch with them and they stay in touch with me. And, you know, they're busy, so we don't want to hound them and all. But one thing that we have here that's kind of unique, we have an alumni weekend every year. You know, most years those guys come back and, you know, show the appreciation for the program and what it, you know, helped them instill in them and lead them to in their professional careers and all that. But, you know, we communicate a lot with those guys, and it's, you know, I think something that, you know, any program, the communication key of it, developmental key of it, is the big key to your program. So those pieces are. So, you know, just happy to have those guys. And I think when you have guys like that who've done well, it helps down the road in recruiting and the other parts of it to continue to get good players.
You and I have talked about this a lot. The evolution of junior college baseball, and the casual mind and almost the lazy mind thinks, well, that's the kid who's not quite ready academically. It's not that at all anymore. You may be wanting to stay close to home. You may be wanting to sign after a year or two. You may just think, I don't know where I want to go to my 4 year yet, so I'm going to go to Chipola and I'm going to use this as a springboard. It's totally changed since, gosh, I was young and thinking about junior college, right?
No doubt. You know, we talk about it all the time, the different type players and people that we're going to get and target here. You know, a lot of it used to be with guys that didn't make grades, and you targeted those guys, or the guy that maybe could go to a low mid major but had the aspirations of going to a high major. You got those guys. Now it's so much different with guys wanting to stay eligible for the draft, wanting to use, you know, especially now, you know, with the way the draft's structured, the slot money type stuff and all that, puts yourself in a position where you can get a higher round more years versus just 1 year. So that's a big piece of it as well. The transfer piece has become a big thing. Two guys go to Division I, and for one reason or another, you know, it didn't work out at one program. They want to transfer back to get to another program or get back into the draft. You know, all those things, I think, play a big part of it.
How incredible are the moments where your team does something special, meaning the 17 and 18 national championship? You won it in 07, but I'm selfish. I was able to be in attendance and behind the microphone at the last two. How special are those? Because it's a lot. You have to win, then you have to win regional, then you have to keep winning in that ridiculously tough World Series in Colorado. How memorable were those two national titles for you guys, 17 and 18?
Well, Darren, you know, for me, I'd always been the coach, and I coached high school ball for 8 years, and, you know, we lost, I think, the state championship game twice when I was in high school. And then we come to junior college and we get beat in the state championship. I think we played in the state championship game 6 years before we ever won it in 07 to get to go to the World Series. So, you know, when you have a chance to win it, we've been fortunate to win it three times, and every year has got its ultimate challenges and different things that kind of happen to get you to that point. It's just, you know, to see the kids and your assistant coaches and all the time and hard work that everybody's put into it, and, you know, the trust factors, the, you know, all the different factors that come into that. It's just, you know, it's just a joy and elation. And after you do it one time, it seems like it becomes a little easier. That first time was probably the toughest time to ever do it. And you have to have a lot of luck, a lot of hard work, and a lot of luck as well to make it happen. But it's, I guess, just a joy. And when you do it, it's an unbelievable feeling.
You guys, in January, you're rolling. I mean, we're waiting for Division I to get started. Excited about it, right? You guys, in January, went 6-1. You're already off and playing. If you don't mind, I would just want to throw three or so players at you and get your scouting report on them. Understand all you other players that are watching this. I didn't mean to leave you out. Let's say that right away. But let me ask you about Andrew Baker. This is a guy that's very highly thought of. He's a big part of who you are as a pitching staff. Tell us, from your perspective, who Andrew Baker is.
Very talented, inexperienced young pitcher. Got a great future in front of him, a great arm. You know, his pitchability is really coming around. We started him last weekend here. It was his first start in front of probably 35, 40 scouts that were here. Just a great future in front, a great kid, a hard worker.
One of the transfers that I'm fond of, because I saw him play a lot, travel ball, high school showcases, is Miles Austin. This is another pro prospect. Who is Miles Austin in your eyes?
You know, Miles transferred in from the University of Alabama. He's come in, he's playing in the middle infield for us. He's leading off, you know, really, really starting to show some explosiveness in his bat, a lot of quick twitch in him. Needs to get a little stronger physically. But, you know, I think he's got a great future in front of him. I think he just needs a bunch of ABs and playing a bunch of games, and I think the sky's the limit for him as well.
Is it similar with Andre Tarver? This was one that I didn't see as much as I did Miles, but this is another guy who's on everyone's boards that he's got a chance of being a pro as well. Tell us about Tarver.
Yeah, he, you know, it's this consistency day in and day out. He needs to continue to go. The tools are off the chart. You know, got a lot of power, hits the ball to all fields. You know, really good right fielder as well. You don't get a lot of credit for that, but an extremely talented outfielder with a good arm.
It's so much fun when you think of the who's who that has come from junior college baseball. We've talked about your guys, but there's this incredible list of players that have gone on to Hall of Fame level careers. Obviously, Albert Pujols pops into my head because he needed a place to play when he came to the United States. But, you know, how proud are you of that deeper list beyond your school of athletes that are having Hall of Fame careers that decided for them, out of high school, junior college baseball was the best choice?
Well, I think we don't get the credit we deserve at this level a lot of times. If you research, which you do, Darren, and you look and look at the amount of players that are playing in the big leagues that are junior college players, you know, I think in the All-Star game a couple of years ago, there were like 18 JUCO guys that were in the All-Star game. And it's an amazing list when you look at it. A lot of times guys playing junior college go to Division I, and they don't really get counted as junior college. Well, that you know that have played, that maybe they're saying they went to another 4-year school after they went junior college. So it's a great path. You know, every, you know, Division I's a great path. They're all great paths, but you need to find the one that fits you individually, to where I don't think anybody's going to get better if they're not on the field playing. And I think that's the thing JUCO wise, a lot of kids are figuring out now, hey, I can go in and play right away at a junior college. I can get 200 at bats. I can throw 100 innings in a season right off the bat as a true freshman. And that's what, you know, professional-wise, gets the scouts' attention and also helps you develop to get where you want to be at the Division I level.
As you get closer to 1,000 wins, I'm always reminded in our conversations about my college coach, QV Lowe. It feels like a very similar atmosphere of development. Obviously, you've been able to develop a lot deeper professionally, but I always enjoy talking baseball with you.
I enjoyed it, man, and thanks for calling us at any time.
And by the way, there was a great moment when you look back just before COVID last year, January of 20, where they dedicated the field to the legendary head coach, Jeff Johnson, deservedly so. He's not a guy that seeks the limelight and the spotlight, but he should get it because with all the wins, and that 17 team's a great example. 11 players drafted off of one junior college team. Okay, so we asked you earlier, the G-Form guess the PG alum. These are some of the clues. He was an All-American, certainly. You can see the scouting report. Actually jumped not back to high school, but to junior college. He was a catcher back then. If you guessed the outfielder now, Bryce Harper, you were correct. I'll never forget, because that was one of my first All-American games as the play-by-play announcer, the batting practice display he put on a couple of days prior at the workout. This is the University of San Diego. Those are dorms. You can see, what, one, two, three, four stories? He was putting the baseball off the roof of the dorms. Again, one of the youngest guys there. He was a year younger than everybody else. He never went back to high school the next year. He played in junior college baseball and was eventually 1-1. Incredible memories. Bryce Harper, perfect game All-American. And it was interesting seeing Harper with those athletes work together. When we come back, a conversation with a guy who didn't have that kind of spotlight at all, but he's built his own. He used his education at Maryland and then his journey through the minor leagues, and he's got some good advice for you. It's the Minnesota Twins, LaMonte Wade, joining us. Glad to have him right around the corner. This is Perfect Game Weekly.
Defense, you can always make a play. Create it in your mind. You're always trying to time when the ball is hitting the bat. Wherever I am, I know where it is. One, two, three, I'm gonna have to start jumping. Nothing more satisfying than making a big play.
Perfect Game Weekly continues with our Yeti Built for the Wild 15U this week travel team rankings and some fun ones. Certainly Lone Star Baseball's out of Austin, Texas. Exposure 14U's out of Chattanooga, Tennessee. Bandito Scout Team, a real special team out of Tomball, Texas. We like the Dallas Tigers because Matthew Stafford and Clayton Kershaw are both alumni of those travel teams. We love the home plate chili dogs as well. Bailey Thorne's my favorite player there out of Phoenix City, Alabama. And then you take a look one through five. Canes out of Boca Raton, Florida. USA Prime, a team out of Greenwood Village, Colorado that went 17-1 last year. Love the Motor City Hit Dogs. There's no such thing as travel teams without having a name like the Motor City Hit Dogs. Parker Pico's on that team. Canes National and Tri-County Prime out of Fresno, California. When they played, they won. They were a perfect 11-0 last year. Over the last couple of weeks, we've been able to connect with athletes that started at the high school and even below that level and played their way on up into college, used college as a springboard, and then onto professional baseball and all the way to the major leagues. LaMonte Wade is one of those athletes. Hey, LaMonte, congratulations on what occurred with you over the last couple of years. And we want to talk about your journey, but how excited are you for the closeness of the 2021 season? Maybe some normalcy when it's all said and done of being able to play baseball and get back out on the field.
Well, thanks for having me first. And like you said, definitely excited to get started here. It's been an interesting year last year, everything that we had to go through. Everybody had to go through, really.
How did you make your decision not only to go to Maryland, but yet, okay, I want to try and grow my game in college?
The University of Maryland was just a great fit for me, one, because it was close to home. And really, when I toured the campus, I really fell in love with the campus, went to a couple games, and felt a good relationship with the coaching staff. So, I mean, it was kind of an easy choice for me.
So, as a man and a baseball player, how did you grow the most? You play with a bunch of dudes, by the way. Your draft class, you had, what, 8 or 9 guys from your team alone get drafted. Yeah. That will make you better. It'll either shrink you or make you better with guys that are that good. But what part of your game improved the most because you chose college baseball?
I would say routine and work ethic, just because we knew that you had to work hard every single day to earn your spot. You also learned a lot about being on time. The only way that you can play on the field is if you were eligible, so you had to take care of your business in the classroom as well. The classroom held you accountable. You're held accountable, and you also held accountable on the baseball field. You got all your baseball stuff, and then you got all your schoolwork, and it can get all overwhelming, but you got to find a way to get to a plan and stick to the routine, and it'll help you kind of find that balance and help you feel more comfortable.
at least since Marilyn Lamont, everyone has talked about your discipline at the plate, your ability to recognize pitches. I kind of laugh at my old-fashioned batting average people when they look at your numbers at 275 in college, because I'll point them right at that 394 on base percentage in your career in college. You just learned to get on a ton through your college time. Did you really grow that way at Maryland? Kind of the whole pitch recognition, the plate discipline, did that really harvest and grow at Maryland?
Oh, for sure. And definitely started at University of Maryland for sure with Coach Sheff and our hitting coach at the time, Rob Vaughn, who's now the head coach, and Matt Swope. We would definitely, that definitely is where it first started. I feel like just because in order to be in the lineup, you had to, they didn't like strikeouts. So if you wanted to be in the lineup, you had to know that you didn't want to strike out. So it was all about how you get on base. It didn't matter how you got on base. It's just fight and claw any way that you can get on base and just to have a quality at bat, because the quality at bat is what gets you in the lineup. And I figured I wanted to be in the lineup. So I just really focused on having quality at bats, which eventually led to walks and getting on base.
And you had some moments, I mean, some incredible things, right? I mean, all of us, if we're lucky enough to play college baseball, hopefully had some. Mine was an AIA, but going as far as we could to the World Series. Yours was an incredible Virginia regional, right, where you took away a home run from UCLA. You beat some very talented teams. Remember, if you can, you're a major leaguer now, so you're doing a different level of memories. But remember, if you can, what that regional was like, what those moments of bonding and experience were like.
Yeah, it was just really cool because we worked so hard that year, knowing that we had lost the previous year to Virginia in the Super Regionals. We just wanted to get back to that point and go beyond. So when we were able to win in UCLA against the number one seed in the tournament, I believe that year, they were number one seed. But the best memories was after the game in the locker room and the hotel, just celebrating with my teammates, was definitely what I remember the most.
When you sign ninth round pick 15 out of Maryland and you go start journeying through the Twins organization, besides the moment when they told you you were going to the big leagues, when were those private moments when you realized, I think I have what it takes? I actually am confident enough in what I've accomplished. Now I'll need some help and a spot to open up. But when did that happen along your pro journey when you thought to yourself, I think I have what it takes?
I would say I had that mindset going in, but I would say that when it clicked to me was, I would say, after my first year in AA in Chattanooga, when we won it all and was a key contributor in that team. And I feel like that was just probably my best year. And that's when I really felt that my confidence was at its peak. And I really feel like I had what it takes.
You made a pretty dramatic change in your approach with your hands at some point during your pro career. You have to have confidence to do that. Describe that change and how it affected you going forward.
That change was just, you know, to be able to get on time and be slow and early. I had too much going on with the hands, and the more movement I had, it took more time, which in this sport we don't have as a hitter. So I just wanted to simplify it. And like you said, each and every year, you got to come up with something in the off season to try and keep working to get better. And that off season, that's where it started, was with the hands. And from there, it's gotten comfortable, like you said, and haven't went back up. So each and every year, though, it's trying to figure out little things within your game, trying to figure out yourself and just how you can improve.
So I want to come with you and live through your eyes and what it was like on June 28th, 2019, when you make your major league debut. LaMonte Sr., Emily, your mom, Jamal, who was recovering from Tommy, all the people you love were there too.
Yeah.
So what did it look like to you? Well, you were in Chicago, correct? White Sox?
I was in Chicago White Sox, yes.
So what did it look like to you? I mean, through your eyes, walking out, being a part of it. You've been to a ballpark 1,000 times at that point, but this is different. What was that debut like?
It was special. I mean, like you said, to have my mom, my dad, my brother there, that just made it even more perfect. But, you know, just waking up that morning, it just felt different. You know, you usually waking up going to minor league park, and then you waking up today and you're going to play in front of, I don't know how many thousands of fans were there, but, you know, it's just a whole different atmosphere. And it was just unbelievable feeling that I'll never forget. And I was just really glad that I was able to share that with my family. That'd be definitely a day we'll never forget. And was definitely grateful to the Twins and everybody for that day.
got drilled, didn't you, in your first plate appearance?
I did. First plate appearance, I got hit in my elbow, and I didn't even feel it. I ran straight down to first base, and I was all smiles. I think that was the first time I've ever gotten hit by a pitch and was smiling. I was smiling the whole way because I had reached first base in a major league game, and it just, you know, it was – I tell you what, I believe my elbow was swollen, but I didn't even feel it, and I had no complaints at all.
See all you folks out there, that's an on-base guy. That's all that is. That's a guy who's getting on base, just like he had to do at Maryland. The home run off Shane Bieber. Now we're talking about first hits, first games. Mm-hmm. This is a guy who we know who he is certainly now. When you get that home run back in September of 2019, in a game that was tied at two, by the way, that had to make you feel great. What's that run around the bases feel like for that first big league home run?
Magical. I mean, you feel like you're floating. Felt like you didn't hear anything. You're just in that moment and just really just trying to take it all in. You know, those are things that you dream of as little kids, hitting home runs in a major league game, and then for it to actually come to fruition, and you know, it's just a dream come true. And like you said, also to be able to get the ball back. Was awesome, and I was able to give it to my parents, who were also at the game, which was really cool.
Yeah. Wow. All these questions I love, and they're all important, but here's the one that I value the most, because there's a lot of our young athletes. If I'm 15, 16, or 17, Lamont, I'm pretty good. Maybe I'm good enough to be drafted out of high school. Maybe I'm good enough to go to college. Mm-hmm. And I've worked to this point to get to my 15 to 17-year age group. What advice do you have for me?
To stay focused, and also to know that in order to play this game, you got to take care of your work in the classroom. It's just as important because, like I said, you can go to college, and that's all great. You can say you're a college baseball player, but in order to play the games, you have to be eligible. So my advice would be to stay focused on and off the field, and to really dedicate yourself to improving as a player and a man each and every day.
Lamont, have a great 2021 season. God bless you and your family. Thanks for taking the time.
I appreciate that. Thank you.
Always love when the athletes, the major leaguers, come on and share the advice for you young players. And I hope that we see all of you in the big leagues. I hope we see you at an upcoming Perfect Game event. When you look ahead at the upcoming schedules, we want to remind you, obviously, this is a tiny sampling of the hundreds of events that are coming up in the next couple of months, but visit perfectgame.org/schedule. Indoor Showcase is epic. Many have come through that event in St. Louis. And then the Perfect Game High School Showdown. It is the premier high school event. And what I'm told, the Academies division this year has a bunch of talented players and teams from Puerto Rico. So not just the high school division, but the Academies. And the other part you need to know, it's on the 4th, 5th, and 6th. You'll be looking at right here on this network about 8 total streamed games. So we're going to be streaming content from there as well. So that'll do it for this edition of Perfect Game Weekly. We want to thank Brian Sakowski. His insights on the junior college ranks, teams, and players unmatched. And that's a great way to describe Jeff Johnson. We thank the legendary junior college head coach, Chipola, out of Florida, for spending time with all of us. And LaMonte Wade, thanks for hanging out with us. Interestingly enough, about 90 minutes after we wrapped up the interview, he was traded to the San Francisco Giants. The journey of baseball continues. By the way, in exchange, Sean Anderson, a 26-year-old right-handed pitcher who averaged about 95 miles an hour on his fastball. Good luck to LaMonte with the San Francisco Giants, a fresh start, and maybe a chance to crack that outfield and head to the Bay Area. Again, thanks for joining us. I'm Darren Sutton. This is Perfect Game Weekly.